together. We're going to worship tonight. For the Lord is good, and His love endures forever. Here we go.
Our time of worship together tonight in the Word. Stand together with me. Let's say this together. Genesis 1:1, John 1:1-2. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. Genesis 1:1, John 1:1-2. All right, while we're getting ready to sing that next song, tell somebody around you, hello, and Seth, that is much better. Thank you, sir. Would you bow? Let's pray together. Father, in this passage that we're going to be reading together tonight, that writer had some struggles. Things weren't working out quite like he'd planned. Things weren't adding up like he had anticipated. He had a gripe or two, a complaint or two. And there appears to be a turning point, a time when he found himself in the place of worship. It was more than an obligatory attendance, more than just the perfunctory gathering. He got there, and in that time and in that place, he had an encounter with you. Always have the formula. I don't always know what makes the difference between just a perfunctory church attendance and a profound encounter with you. I'm not sure at all what always makes the difference between checking off the moral obligation of having been in church and finding ourselves face to face with the living God. But somewhere in there, in that encounter, the whole perspective changed. The whole understanding of circumstances was altered. My prayer tonight, Father, is that somehow or another in these minutes, we move beyond that perfunctory attendance, the compulsory participation in the religious activity. Somehow or another in these moments, have that divine human encounter that is worship. And I pray that it will change us. I pray that it will alter the way we see where we are even at this very moment. And I want to go ahead and thank you. I realize that we're not waiting on you to come through. We're not waiting on you to show up and be God. We don't have to worry about that. You're going to do that. It's us. We're the wild card, the unpredictable ones. And I hope we can get it together and meet you. And I thank you for what's going to happen as we do, and if we do. In Christ we praise you. Amen. I want to sing that verse. I want all to join on that chorus.
love abide, God will take care of you.
Sing with me.
God
I'll make a bold prediction. After last Sunday night, looking at Psalm 51, which, I mean, if you're a student of the Psalms, Psalm 51 is a rich one. I mean, it is so good. And if you do a halfway decent job of looking at that and studying that, you come away impressed by the psalmist and his struggle to find forgiveness. And a couple of folks came up after church and said, you should have saved that one for Sunday morning. That needed to be a Sunday morning sermon. And so, you know, I mean, I get the sentiment of that, but it's not like you get the irregulars. I mean, this isn't like the outlet over in Sulphur Springs where you got the cheap blue jeans because one leg was 3 inches shorter than the other. Sunday night is not for the irregular sermons. It's for worship. We worship together on Sunday night. My bold prediction is that I don't know that anybody will say that when we're finished tonight. Probably will not. Psalm 73 is a bit different. It's off that beaten path for sure. And what I would like to do tonight, I'm going to read it. It's lengthy. I'm going to read through it, and I want you to listen carefully as we read through it, picking up some nuances. I'll probably stop even as I'm reading it and point you to a couple of phrases, a couple of words. Read through it, listening carefully to what the Lord has to say. And then when we finish, I've got 3 points. Now, I will tell you that typically I when I'm ready for you, I've got anywhere between 3.5 to 5 pages of notes in my extended outline, typically. Tonight I've got one. So that typically would mean that it's going to be a shorter sermon. It's not always true. Sometimes I get carried away, and before you know it, 35 minutes is used up, and we're through point number one. So anyway, a lot of this is going to be on you. And I want to give you something and let you take it with you and let the Lord do with it what you will. We've sung about it tonight. Brother Tim's done a great job putting together an order of worship that makes the assertion that we will begin with in the first verse of Psalm 73. It is an assumption almost. I think it is the statement of the believer, the statement of the faithful. It is what we are programmed to say and to believe. It has been ingrained into us, and so with a degree of comfort and confidence, the psalmist wrote, and we join him in saying, surely God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in heart. In my English translation of Scripture, at the end of verse 1, there's an exclamation point, which means that you raise your voice a little bit with confidence. You say, surely God is good to all of us, particularly to those who are pure in heart. We would amen. Yes, we've sung about it. God is so good. God is so good. There's a pause, I believe, a natural wait in the word for just a moment. The wheels are spinning. I know that I just said, and I know that I'm supposed to believe that God is good, but let me tell you what I see. And now we launch off into what's right there in front of him, the real, the present. But as for me, my feet came close to stumbling. My steps had almost slipped, and now the why. For I was envious of the arrogant, as I saw the prosperity of the wicked. For there are no pains in their death, and their body is fat. Now that's not fat shaming. That's just a statement. They got plenty to eat. These folk are not going without. They are not wormy looking. These people are well fed. They're not in trouble as other men, nor are they plagued like mankind. Therefore, pride is their necklace. The garment of violence covers them. Their eye bulges from fatness. The imaginations of their heart run riot. They mock and wickedly speak of oppression. They speak from on high. They have set their mouth against the heavens, and their tongue parades through the earth. Therefore, his people return to this place, and waters of abundance are drunk by them. They say, how does God know? And is there knowledge with the Most High? Behold, these are the wicked, and always at ease they have increased in wealth, and surely in vain I have kept my heart pure. Remember, he said, God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in heart. Surely in vain I've kept my heart pure and washed my hands in innocence, for I have been stricken all day long and chastened every morning. If I had said, I will speak thus, behold, I would have betrayed the generation of your children. When I pondered to understand this, it was troublesome in my sight. I think there's another pause. For me, there is a wait. Before I go further, this is irritating, frustrating, troubling, aggravating, and it doesn't make a lick of sense. Because I have been one of those who've said God is good. I've been one of those who've attempted to keep my heart pure before God in my praying and in my Bible reading and in my worship. And what do I get? Doom, despair, in agony on me. Deep, dark depression. Excessive misery. If it weren't for bad luck, I'd have no luck at all. Gloom, despair, and misery on me. Now that came from a wise sage of old on Hee Haw, Saturday night, standard fare in the Davis household. Some of you remember that. You were right there with me. Verse 17, there's a turn. Until I came into the sanctuary of God, Then I perceived their end. Surely you set them in slippery places. You cast them down to destruction. How they are destroyed in a moment. They are utterly swept away by sudden terrors. Like a dream when one awakes, O Lord, when aroused, you will despise their form. When my heart was embittered and I was pierced within, then I was senseless and ignorant. He's back now. He's thinking back to where he's just been before he went into the sanctuary. I was senseless and ignorant. I didn't get it. I was like a beast, an animal, a pet before you. Nevertheless, I am continually with you. You have taken hold of my right hand, and with your counsel you will guide me, and afterward receive me to glory. Whom have I in heaven but you? And besides you, I desire nothing on earth. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. For behold, those who are far from you will perish. You've destroyed all those who are unfaithful to you, but as for me, the nearness of God is my good. I have made the Lord God my refuge, that I may tell of all your works. Interestingly, there's a segue from this morning to tonight. You'll recall in that passage in 1 Corinthians, Paul was lamenting the fact that those folk there in Corinth felt like they were so there. They were so intelligent and so blessed, and their life was so good. Kings, he called them, somewhat sarcastically. While he then recounted that, you know what, it hasn't been a bed of roses for us. We've had a few challenges. We've had some times where we didn't have much to eat, didn't have really good clothes to wear, didn't have a nice place to lay our heads down, and yet we were attempting to be faithful. And he pointed at them, I think, and said, and that doesn't make any sense to you because you think that when you are right with God, you get all the goody, you get all the blessing. And when things like I've just described happen to you, then that must mean that you're far away from the Lord. The psalmist in Psalm 73 comes directly to that place and begins with an assumption. And it is, I think, the assumption of the faithful. What good Bible-believing, God-fearing, Christian Baptist is not going to join in at some point in the Sunday school lesson or the worship service when prompted by the leader, and we say, God is good, and you say, like Pavlov's dog, we hear the bell and we salivate. God is good all the time, and then we walk away. The assumption of the faithful, the assumption of the righteous is that, yes, God is good. And that was our first prayer. God is good. God is great. Let us thank Him for the food. Yea, God. Surely God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in heart. God is good. But then we've got to define that good. What does that mean? When you say, on the occasion when you declare God is good, what prompted that? What was the occasion for your testimony, for your declaration? We want to say, we want to testify to the fact that God is good. On Wednesday night, we have an opportunity to praise God together. We give opportunity to share brief testimonies of God's goodness in our life. And what are the occasions when somebody's sitting there trying to figure out, do I have anything to share? Do I have anything to tell? What are these people talking about? What does it mean for God to be good? Good is, well, it's when I'm healthy. Right? When I've been sick and I got well, God is good. When I had cancer and now I'm in remission, God is good. When I had a heart attack and they were able to stent me or do open heart surgery and restore the plumbing in my heart, and now I'm able to walk around and breathe normally, amen, God is good. When I lost a little weight and I was able to get off my blood pressure medicine, when I quit eating all that sweet stuff and I was able to get off metformin, God is good. My wayward child, who has been sick and finally got well, God is so good. Okay, that's one, two. God is good when I'm happy. I see that. Folks come in on Wednesday night oftentimes, and they're smiling when they come through the door. There's a spring in their step. Oh, I've got something good to share tonight. Oh, what's that? And then they tell the scenario, and it has made them glad. I am a happy, happy camper, and I want to tell somebody about it. Ooh, it's so good. It's a good day. Hallelujah. Amen. I'm happy. God is good. He's good when I'm comfortable. We're not so much right now. I rehearsed that this morning. We are uncomfortable. We're tired of these circumstances. We're ready for some comfort. We're ready for somebody to put things back to more normal days. And to be able to not worry, to fret, to fear, to not be on edge about what may happen next. No, we don't like that. I mean, I don't like Putin when he starts rambling about using nuclear weapons in Ukraine. I don't like it when the Iranian Ayatollah starts talking about unleashing a nuclear holocaust on Israel. Not that we live in the Ukraine or in Israel, but I know us well enough to know that if Putin unleashes a nuclear holocaust on Ukraine, if the Ayatollah unleashes a nuclear holocaust on Iran, guess what? We're going to go to the party. It won't take us long. We'll be there. And that's not going to be very comfortable. No, I want world peace. Not so much because I care about those folk over there having peace. It just makes me a little more comfortable when things aren't quite so on edge in other parts of the world. Good. God is good when I am financially secure. Oh, I don't need to be rich. I'm not going to be like that sister that was charging $1,500 for the prayer conference. I could do that. I don't know how many of you would pay. I don't know what secret I could disclose about prayer that would be worth $1,500 in a seminar. But she actually had people sign up. Woo, have mercy. You know, I'm not worried about somebody coming in during church and stealing all of my millions of dollars worth of jewelry. I don't have it. I mean, it's not hidden. It's here. I've got a wedding band that Cindy gave me 43 plus years ago. It's the same one. I'm still wearing it. You say, oh, that's sweet. No, I just can't get it off my fat finger. And so I've got to wear it until the sucker breaks. So it's not that. I mean, I've probably got more than I should have, but there's always more to be had. God is good when I'm financially secure. God is good when I am on the winning side. Whatever that is, I like for my team to win. I don't know if your team won yesterday or not. I don't know. I lost my Dish Network last Sunday afternoon. God judged me, and he blinded my Dish Network all week. Called them, and they said the earliest we can get out is Monday. So my anticipation, a dude's going to come out tomorrow and look at it and say, we got to order a part. It's going to be 6 months. So I don't know whether my team won or not. I'm not even sure they played yesterday or not, but I like it when my team wins. Makes me happy. God is good. So if you follow that line of reasoning, what happens when those things are not true? Then do we just remain silent? We don't want to be a false witness. No, God is good. I'm just waiting for Him to crank up again. God is good. I'm waiting for another season of His goodness. But until then, I'll just quietly bide my time and wait. The psalmist wasn't so much about waiting and biding his time. He just decided to go ahead and be out with it. The dilemma of the faithful. Three words. I'm struggling. I mean, this isn't making any sense, and I'm not going to read it again. I read it to you. You followed along with me there as we listened to him basically say, I don't like it. I don't like it that those who one, don't believe in you. They've had plenty to eat. Even their deaths are easy. Do you hear a little bit of righteous spite in there? God, I want them to die. And when they die, I want them to suffer. I want to hear them cry out in pain. I want to see them writhe in the bed. I want them to be covered with sores, bed sores that are running and oozy. I want them to cry out for relief and find. Now, that's what I want, God. But no, they're dying, and they're dying with a smile on their lips. Makes me mad. I don't like it, and they're fat. They got plenty of food to eat. They're eating the good food too. They're not having to eat potted meat and spam. They're not eating soda crackers and white rice. They're eating the good stuff. I mean, they got the fat still around their mouth where they ate the choicest cuts. And their eyeballs are bulging. You know, when somebody's puny, their eyeballs kind of sink into their head. You know, they're kind of gaunt looking and they've got that hollow-eyed look. In fact, we'll refer to it as that. When somebody's real healthy, fat, and please, I'm not fat shaming any of you in the room. So don't go away saying that. Brother Clint said I'm fat. I did not. But if the shoe fits, you're going to have to wear it. So he said their eyes are bulging with fatness. They're not hollow-eyed at all. There's so much of them in there, it's pushing their eyeballs out. They are blessed. They are good. And I don't like it. They're prospering. I'm struggling with that. Why they're getting all the goody and I'm having to do without. And it makes me mad that they are blaspheming you. It's okay that they ignore you. I can live with that, but they are talking ugly about you. They're saying things about you, God, that are offensive to me. Vile, profane. And I, you know, I think they're deserving of a lightning bolt from heaven. Let's not wait until the end. Let's not wait until the judgment day. God, you can do it. Just open up the heavens and come on. Nothing but a greasy spot, a smoldering, you know, because they're so fat, a smoldering little puddle of yellow fat. The only reminder that they've been here. And I would be righteously content. They had it coming. But no. They blaspheme you. And he has struggled in every imaginable way with this truth. Bad people prosper, good people suffer. And it doesn't make any sense. So what do you do with that? How do you take that up with God? What is your appeal? What is your cry to God? When deep down inside you want to say God is good, but it's been a while. When deep down inside you believe, you say, I believe, I say, God is good. Even, we will go further, all the time. Maybe not right now. And then we want to take that up with God. You see this happening, God? You see that happen? Do you hear them? Do you see them? What are you going to do about that, God? We'll even go so far as to say that if God doesn't do something about them, about that group, about that party, about that stance, about that belief, then he's going to have to write an apology to Sodom and Gomorrah. Huh. The conclusion of the faithful. I prayed this a moment ago, and I'm not altogether sure I know exactly what this meant for him. It wasn't until I went in to the sanctuary of God. I got to a place where God and I met face to face. I finally was able to put aside my anger and frustration. I was able to put aside my perverted ideas about what is right and wrong and what God owes me and what should be coming my way. I was able to kind of push that over to the side and sit in that place of sanctuary, in that place of divine human encounter, and I met the Lord, and in that place I then began to see truth. I perceived their end, he wrote. I don't think it was in that moment that he saw the suffering of the wicked, that he saw the demise of the wicked, the judgment of the wicked, and it satisfied him. You know, that'll be good enough. They'll get theirs in the end. It was, I believe, that he came into the presence of the Lord and had this realization that, okay, God, I guess I've played your part long enough, and I need to stop trying to be God and let you be God, and I'm going to go ahead and be me. And I'm going to trust in your character, that you're going to, in your time and in an appropriate way, you're going to take care of those who are unrighteous. You will judge them. And you're going to be complete and righteous in that judgment. And I'm okay with that. If they're fat and sassy, happy as a clam, enjoying the bounty of life now, I'm just going to have to trust you with that. If I am not, I'm doing without, I'm struggling, I am in a dark place from time to time. I'm going to have to trust you with that and to be real enough in my faith to be willing to lay hold of you. With your counsel, you will guide me after you've taken hold of my right hand. And then at some point, yep, you're going to receive me to glory. But it brings us to this conclusion, to this verse that we've sung about already tonight, with the question, whom have I in heaven but you? And besides you, I desire nothing on earth. My flesh and my heart may fail. Yes. Yes. I may struggle. And I may do without for a part of my life. I may go through a season that is challenging beyond explanations. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. You, God, you keep me going. You, God, you keep the gyroscope of my life functional so that I don't get wonky and wander off somewhere I have no business being. You keep me moving forward and you sustain me in those moments. You let me know what really matters. You deliver me from my pettiness, from my flippancy. You deliver me from all that and bring me back to that place of blessing. But as for me, the nearness of God is my good. Hey, back to our question, what does it mean for God to be good? It's just to know that He's right here. Not somewhere far off, not absent, not blind, not on a vacation, but God, you are right here. And as long as you're here, as long as you can just reach over every now and then, and we're doing a little bit of anthropomorphizing here, we're making God like us, but as long as every now and then, God, you can just reach over and as we're sitting next to each other, just pat me on the leg and say, I'm here. Hey, I'm here. The nearness of God is my good. Period. I don't have to be healthy, financially secure, happy, comfortable, any of those things. Clint, I'm here. We're good. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, some really bad people are doing really well. Some really good people are struggling. And Father, it doesn't add up. It doesn't go together. Forgive us for being affected by a very materialistic world, an individualistic world, and thinking that we know how things ought to be, how they ought to work out. Forgive us for getting impatient with you and even running ahead of you and trying to fix things ourselves. I pray, Father, for patience and the wisdom to come into that place of sanctuary, that place where you are. Oh, and it can be here in worship. It can be here in Bible study, but it can be at home in our quiet time, in our time of prayer and Bible study. It can be driving down the road and you just show up and reveal yourself to us. It can be anywhere, anywhere that it needs to be, where we come into your presence and you remind us over and over, you're God and we are your creation. You are the only God and we are a part of that that you have made, and you are the one who has given us life, and we just need to trust you and walk with you. So my prayer is tonight in this invitation to help us get over ourselves. Please, God, help us to get beyond our pettiness and our irrationality, our times of being as dumb as a household pet. Give us wisdom, God, to be able to hold on to that outstretched hand and to allow you to lead us, and to get to that place where we can say with a quiet confidence, the nearness of God is my good. I pray it in Jesus' name.